once I got to know the chimpanzees, and I got to know them as individuals, I named them, I gradually learned how like us chimpanzees are.
It's an honor to be joined by Dame Dr. Jane Goodall, the legendary primatologist and anthropologist best known for her groundbreaking research of wild chimpanzees. Jane, thank you so much for taking the time to be with us today.
I'm very happy to be with you today. Thank you.
So can we go back to the very beginning? You've been fascinated by the natural world since an early age. All those years ago, what drew you into the world of nature?
Well, I was born loving animals, you know, and when I was growing up, television wasn't invented. None of these modern gadgets like cell phones and iPads. So I learned in two ways about this love of animals. One was outside. We got a big garden. It's still there. And there were squirrels and hedgehogs and all sorts of insects, birds, of course. And I watched them. And then books, because I learned about animals through reading a lot of books. I've always loved books. And when I was 10, I found this little book in a secondhand shop. We didn't have any money. It was during the war. And I just had saved up enough of my few pennies of pocket money to buy it. It was Tarzan of the Apes. So I took it back home, climbed my favorite tree, and read it from cover to cover. And of course, I fell passionately in love with this glorious lord of the jungle. And what did he do? He went and married the wrong Jane. That was when my dream began.
So last year marked the 50th anniversary of your arrival in what is now known as Gombe Stream National Park in Tanzania, where it all began, your incredibly groundbreaking research on chimpanzees. Back then, the odds were low for you to even get there. A young woman in your early 20s without a science degree. How did you manage?
Well, first of all, I went out to Kenya to stay with a friend. And then I heard about and met the famous paleontologist, Lewis Leakey. And he was curator of the Natural History Museum. I think he was impressed by how much I knew because I'd read everything I could about African animals. So he gave me this extraordinary opportunity of going to study the chimps. It took him a year to get the money. I mean, as you say, it was unheard of then. And I hadn't even been to college. Finally, he got some money from an American philanthropist. Secondly, at that time, Tanzania was Tanganyika. It was taken over by the Brits from the Germans, German East Africa it used to be. And the authorities, still British at that time, 1960, they refused permission. Can't have this young girl coming out on her own. So Lewis Leakey persisted. And in the end, they said, yes, but she must have a companion. She cannot come alone. So the volunteer was my amazing mother. So we had money for 6 months, literally on a shoestring. And mum could stay 4 months. By the end of that, the authorities were, well, Jane may be a bit crazy, but she's all right. Because nobody had studied chimpanzees. Nobody knew anything about them in the wild.
Can you talk to us a little bit about how you managed to succeed in what was a male-dominated space at the time?
Well, actually being a woman benefited me. One, because Lewis Leakey felt that women might be better in the field, more patient. And secondly, because the Tanzanians were about to become independent. And after independence, you can imagine they were a little bit resentful of white males who dominated them for so long. But a girl and her mother, they wanted to help, definitely. And I think possibly our voices are different a little bit. Maybe that helped with the chimps, I don't know. But, you know, obviously, once I got to know the chimpanzees and I got to know them as individuals. I named them, and then I wrote down everything. I mean, I was every single day up in the mountains before daylight, and I got back just before dark to have supper with Mum around the fire. And so, you know, when I gradually learned how like us chimpanzees are. I mean, we know that they're our closest relative genetically. We share 98.6% of DNA with them. And in behavior, well, the nonverbal communication, kissing, embracing, patting one another, kissing in greeting, swaggering, shaking the fist, using tools, using rocks as weapons when they fight each other. They do have a dark, aggressive side. But they also have a loving and altruistic side. And they have these close bonds between family members. That's the mother and her offspring. Papa, well, they're very promiscuous, and we never knew who the fathers were. We can find out now by DNA sampling from feces, but back then we just had to guess. But anyway, when Lewis Leakey sent me to Cambridge University to do this PhD, I got a letter telling me this. I was up in the mountains, and he said, "You're doing a PhD in ethology." I hadn't the remotest idea what ethology meant. And, you know, in those days, you waited for a letter back and forth about 2 weeks, unless it was really important, and then a telegram, but they were expensive. And we still had very little money. So shock when I got to Cambridge and was told chimpanzees should have been numbered, not named. That's more scientific. And you shouldn't talk about them having personalities, minds capable of problem solving, and certainly not emotions like happiness, sadness, fear, despair, grief, and so on, because those are unique to humans. But I knew they were wrong, and I knew they were wrong because of my childhood teacher. He's always up here near me. That's my dog, Rusty. And you cannot share your life in a meaningful way with a dog, a cat, a rabbit, a rat, a horse, a bird, and not know the professors were wrong. So I just quietly went on talking about them as I knew they were. I didn't confront the professors. And fortunately, my supervisor, who's one of the top three ethologists in the world, he came to Gombe. And after 2 weeks, he wrote to me and said, "Jane, I've learned more about animal behavior in those 2 weeks than any time in my life before." So gradually, science has come to accept that we are part of and not separate from the rest of the animal kingdom. Still some resentment, still people wanting to use numbers, but it's changing.
Do you think the fact that actually you made your discoveries before you had the relevant qualification did help you? Were you more open-minded?
Well, it was when I saw the tool using, and that was David Greybeard. He's up here behind me as well. And I saw David Greybeard, the first chimp to begin to lose his fear of me, using grass stems to fish for termites and picking leafy twigs and stripping the leaves to make that into a tool. And, you know, at the time, scientists believed humans and only humans used and made tools. In fact, we were defined as man, the toolmaker. And so that was so exciting back then that Leakey was able to go to the National Geographic Society, and they agreed to continue to fund my research after the 6 months money was over. And they also sent out a photographer and filmmaker, Hugo van Lawick, to record what I was seeing. So when his documentaries began to move around, you know, people just had to believe that what I was saying was true.
Since those early days of research and discovery in Gombe, how far have we come?
Well, we're in our 61st year now, since I got to Gombe in 1960. And we're now, you know, we're using a lot more technology, like GPS, GIS, We are mapping chimp range and chimp habitat across Africa. And Gombe's trained many, many young scientists. They've got their experience in Gombe and written papers and PhDs. But we're still daily with the chimps. We're now into the fourth generation. And this enables us to look back over all those years of data. And we find, lo and behold, there are good and bad chimp mothers. And the good ones are affectionate, but mainly, main thing is they're supportive, like my mother. And we can now say for sure that the offspring of the supportive mothers do better. The males reach a higher place in the male hierarchy, and the females are better mothers.
Let's shift gear and talk a little about nature. We talked about the draw to nature for you as a child, and however, it doesn't seem to exist as prevalently today. At what point did we become more disconnected from the environment?
Well, I never became disconnected from it, but I left Gombe in 1986. I visited twice a year always because at a conference where different, by that time, there were different chimpanzee researchers across Africa. And it was a conference to try and find out if chimp behavior differed from one environment to the next, which it does. They do in fact have primitive cultures. But we had a session on conservation and it was absolutely shocking. Right across wherever chimps were studied, forests were going, chimp numbers were dropping. And we had a session on conditions in some captive situations. And I couldn't sleep for nights after seeing our closest relatives, very social, in 5 foot by 5 foot cages in medical research labs. And some of them had been there for 15 years or so. And it was just awful. I knew when I left that conference, I went as a scientist and I left as an activist because I didn't know what to do, but I knew I had to try to help. So the lab situation went on for years and talking to different people. Finally, chimps are out of invasive research. The Africa problem, I thought, well, I need firsthand information. So I managed to get together some money and went to, I think it was 6 of the research stations. And I learned a lot about the problems facing the chimps, you know, the destruction of the habitat, the bushmeat trade, that's the commercial hunting of wild animals for food, being caught in snares set by hunters for bush pigs and so on. But at the same time, I learned about the plight of so many African people living in and around chimp habitat, the crippling poverty, the lack of good health and education facilities, the degradation of the land as populations grew. And it hit me when I flew over Gombe. It's a tiny national park, the smallest in Tanzania. And when I began, it was part of a great forest equatorial belt across Africa. And when I flew over in the late 1980s, I was shocked. There was a little island of forest that was the national park, and all around were completely bare hills. And that's when it hit me. If we don't help these people find ways of making a living without destroying the environment, cutting down the trees to get some fertile soil to grow food or to make charcoal, if we can't do that, then we can't save chimpanzees, forests, or anything else. And so we began our program, Take Care, or TACARI, as we call it. Very holistic program, which, you know, includes things like helping them restore fertility to the overused farmland without chemicals, let me hasten to add. And water management programs, worked with the government to improve the schools and the clinics, or even build clinics, because many villages didn't have them. And scholarships to keep girls in school, microcredit, microfinance programs for women, particularly women, based on Muhammad Yunus's Grameen Bank. And our youth program, we started up in all the schools. So this program, Shikari, started in the 12 villages around Gombe. It's now spread to all the villages throughout Chimpta range in Tanzania. That's 104 villages. And we've trained volunteers from the villages to use smartphones to monitor the health of their forest reserves, which is where most of Tanzania's wild chimps are, not protected at all. And this program has now spread to six other African countries around chimp habitat. And the thing is that they've understood that protecting the environment isn't just for wildlife, it's for their own future.
Do you want to talk about the two main organizations that you founded, the Jane Goodall Institute and Roots and Shoots, and what the main missions of the two organizations are?
Well, Roots and Shoots is a program of the Jane Goodall Institute, just like our work with the villagers. We have various programs. The Institute was started back in 1977, actually in California, where some friends of mine said, you know, Jane needs to have her own institute and not rely on yearly grant applications, which was nerve-wracking and took up so much time. So there are now around 30 Jane Goodall Institutes in different countries. And Roots and Shoots is a program of JGI. JGI does research, conservation, and education. And the education part is Roots and Shoots, which began in 91. So we have 30th anniversary. It began with 12 high school students in Tanzania. And they were concerned about all kinds of things. They came to talk to me from eight different schools. They were worried about the illegal dynamite fishing. Some of them were concerned about the poaching in the national parks. Some of them worried about the street children with no homes. Some of them were concerned about the cruel treatment of stray dogs and animals in the market. And so I told them, go and get your friends who care. And we had this meeting, and Roots and Shoots was born with the main message, every single one of us makes an impact on the planet every single day. But we get to choose what kind of impact we make. And secondly, because everything is interrelated, each group would choose, they would choose, we weren't dictating to them, three projects, one to help people, one to help animals, one to help the environment. And Roots and Shoots is now in over 60 countries. And it's got, you know, we've got what I call the alumni, all those who've been through the program. And in Roots and Shoots, they acquire values. They acquire value of respect, respect for each other. And not to, to realize that far more important than the color of your skin or your language or your nationality, whether you're rich or poor, etc., much more important than all that is the fact that we're all human. We're all human beings. And we should be a family. And I suppose there's always quarrels within a family, but the global problems are a bit more than quarrels. But still, that's what Roots and Shoots, the values that the young people acquire. So it starts with kindergarten and even some preschoolers, and university very strong, and everything in between. And I have just started something else, which is the Jane Goodall Legacy Foundation, because, you know, I'm 87 and I want this work to go on when I'm gone. And sometimes one of the institutes kind of goes through a really bad time. That's happened with this pandemic, actually. And so this will build up an endowment.
We talked all this time about land. How about the sea?
Oh, the sea, yes, indeed. The sea, the two great lungs of the world. One is the forests and also peatlands and grasslands, but especially the tropical forests with their rich biodiversity. And they are carbon sinks. They absorb carbon dioxide and store it in the roots and in the ground. And as we cut them down and destroy them, so the carbon dioxide goes back into the atmosphere. Then you have the ocean, which also absorbs CO2 and gives out oxygen. And in the ocean are these kelp forests. It's a lovely way of joining land and sea, because the kelp forests actually store more CO2 than the forests on land. And I like to connect the two with these mangrove forests, which are doing so much to prevent erosion from the rising sea levels. So cleaning up the ocean, because we so badly polluted it, it's become acidic in some places, and then it can't absorb CO2 any longer. And so many millions of people depend on fishing, but these commercial companies with their dredging, their long lines, their drift nets, absolutely, totally destroying fish stocks everywhere. And all the bycatch, the turtles and even seagulls tangled up in the nets, and dolphins and whales as well, and drowning. You know, we just have to somehow get this thing right before it's too late.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm amazed you're in your 88th year, but you don't seem to be slowing down. What continues to motivate you and spur you on?
Well, first of all, I'm obstinate. I won't give in. Secondly, I care. I care passionately about nature, and I care about children and their future. And rather than slow down, when you're in your 88th year, you know, however long you have ahead of you, it's less than it was the year before. And there's still so much to do. And, you know, I wouldn't bother, except I get hundreds of letters or people talking to me saying, after I heard your lecture, after I read your book, blah, 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 I promise I'll do my bit. I had given up, but now I promise to do my bit. So how can I stop?
Jane, it has been such a pleasure to speak with you. You're one of those few special people around the world that truly give people hope to make change. Thank you for inspiring. Thank you for making such a positive change. And thank you for your time today.
And thank you. Thank you for inviting me and talking to me. And thanks to all the people listening. And I'll end off with a greeting, a distance greeting of the chimpanzee to all of you, which is...